Hello, hello everybody, my name is NoFox and I want to welcome you to my video for the TryHackMeRoom Linux Fundamentals Part 3. As we can see, I am already connected to the network via OpenVPN connection, and today we are going to do this room together. This is my third attempt of recording this, because the first one was completely messy. And the second one was completely dumped, so let's hope that this one will work. I won't read everything that will stand here in the rooms. I will just show you how you can most likely solve this room and hope you will learn something. So let's start with this little introduction here. You can read it if you want, it's just what you're going to learn in this room. So I hit completed, and the second task is deploying your Linux machine. You can always deploy your Linux machines by pressing the huge green button here. If you do this, then you will see this box. Here we have a timer of around 1 minute, and if it counts to 0 seconds, then there will be an IP that we will use to work. So I've logged into Linux Fundamentals Part 3 machine using SSH and have deployed the attack box successfully. This will be our SSH credentials that we will use to work with this box. Okay, this will be quite easy and we will do it together. You have another option if you don't use Linux, you can always use the attack box here. You have two options, Kali Linux or the attack box per se. You can do both how you want it. If you hit this button, you will have a split screen with a VNC connection box right here and the normal box right here. So it's almost done. All right, our IP is 10.10.222.245. We will copy it because we will need it. So let's open an SSH connection to this box. I recommend you to wait around 3 minutes. So if on expires you see 1 hour and 57 minutes, I would recommend you to connect to the box. Otherwise it might not be completely booted and you will most likely need to wait a bit. Let's see. You can try it. Nope, not fully booted yet. Like I said, wait around 1:57 and you might be able to connect yourself to the SSH server. Okay, still nothing. 10.10.222.245. Ah, now we have it. It will ask you if you are sure to connect, and then it will ask you for a password. We have both, so let's start. Now we have our connection to the SSH server and can hit completed. So the next thing we are going to see are the terminal text editors. We have two here called Nano and Vim. I would recommend you to use Nano because Vim, for beginners in Linux, Vim is really complicated and you don't want this. So use Nano and it will be quite fine and easy. We will now use together Nano for the rest of the challenge. So create a file using Nano. Sure thing you're going to do. Echo test my file. Nano my file. And now we are in Nano with the file called my file and the text called test. If you want to save it now, you could hit Control, hold it, and then hit O. Then it will ask you if you want to save it. We hit yes. If you want to leave it, hit Control and X, and you will leave Nano. Edit task 3 located in TryHackMe's home directory using Nano. What's the flag? So we should use a file with Nano. Now we have the file name called task 3. And the flag is called this here. we will use it and hit on both completed because we just completed them. General useful utilities. So now we learn how to connect back and forth to an SSH server to copy files from local and not local. So let's say we are having a file here called touch I want transfer. We want to copy this file to our local PC. So we say SCP. Let's use wget first. It's quite more easy. For wget, we want to have a local web server living in the SSH server. So we are using Python 3 -m http.server and then any port you want, like 1234. Oh, I mistyped. Sorry. Now we have this server. So let's say we want to get it. Then we type wget https. It's not really important if I use HTTP or HTTPS, but yeah. 10.10.222.224. Come on. 1234 for the port, and then I want. Before I mistype again, like in the last time I recorded this, I'm going to copy it and paste it. And then it's not possible to use an SSH connection. Okay. Now we have it. I needed to remove the S from HTTPS. Let's see if it's in our directory. Yep. Here is it. I want transfer. So you can do this on both ways. So if you're going to start in this command on your local box and you're going to use this command on this box but with the right IP. If you don't know your IP, it's either you type IP address and search for TAN0, or you're just going to look here top the other two. So then now we know how to do with Python. Now we need another comment called SCP. I just hinted at what SCP does. Let's say we have here touch my SCP. I'm dumb. My SCP folder. You don't need to know this, what I'm doing here right now. So let's see. I want transfer as well. Now we have here a file called I want transfer as well. And we have this SSH connection and our local connection. We want now to copy the file from local to our SSH, which means we are typing SCP, I want transfer as well, to tryhackme at 10.10.222.245 home tryhackme, I want transfer as well. He will now ask us for the password. We will give it to him. And if I didn't type anything bad on our SSH connection, we should now have, yep, our file that we wanted to transfer. So on the exact same way, you can transfer it forth and back to the SSH server. You just need to change these two things into the right order. So if in case you want to copy it from the SSH machine to your local, you would do this first and then this. Like I will show you. Let's say we are here now. SCP tryhackme. On one directory I see. Sorry. try hack me at 10:10 to do 2:05. Home try hack me. Then we copy. Come on. This to I want. Let's say it like this. Then it will again ask you for your password. You will give it to it. And then we are going to take a look. And there we have it. We just copied our file from and to SSH. So we just did on any of this. Completed. Now use Python's 3 HTTP server module to set a web server in the home directory of the TryHackMe user on deploy instance. Alright. We just did this. Let's verify this. PWD, we're in the right directory. So now we're going to do this. And now we want to have the file. We can completely copy this one. It doesn't really make a difference. We can completely copy this, paste it here. It copies our flag. But right now there's a little fun stuff. Let's say you're now going to use ls minus l. You see, there are only two files that we can see now, but we just downloaded a file called .flag.txt. What do we do now? How do we see it? Sure, we could use cat, but let's say we type ls minus al. Ah, you see something? I do. Because it's handled as an invisible file. So, there we have our flag. And then we copy as HTML. We just copy it, paste it here, and we are done. So now we are supposed to hit Command and C, and it is finished. So, processes 101, the next part of this room. Each or every Linux on this world has processes in it. These processes show us what the Linux is currently doing and how much it needs to do stuff. So let's say we are going to use ps aux, and there we have a lot of things that it can show us. And if something froze us or something you don't know, how do I say this? If something is hung or you want to kill something out of some reasons, you can look for the PID here and kill it with this PID or restart it. As you might have already seen, we have a flag here. So, we can totally copy this because why not? Next thing we are going to do is looking if we find something here. So, if we were to launch a process with the previous ID was 300, what would the ID of this new process be? So, if we already have a process called 300, and you see that it's going increasingly counting here, you can definitely need to see that we have 301. Because after 300, there's 301, except if there's already and process with the ID of 301, so it would count even higher. If we wanted to cleanly kill a process, what signal would we send? So, let's go back a bit higher here. If we want to cleanly kill it, here we have here three things. Sick term, kill the process but allow it to do some cleanup tasks before, and sickle, kill this process doesn't do any cleanup after the fact. Sick stop, stop and suspend the process. You should definitely write down these three things and the kill comment, because you will need it if you're going to work with processes on Linux systems. So, we want the first one here. Let's see if it's working. Yep. What comment would we use to stop the service my service? we would use systemctl stop my service. In case you're asking why I know this, it's here. So I will read this with you because it's important. Some applications can be started on the boot of the system that we own, for example web servers, database servers or file transfer servers. This software is often critical and is often told to start during the boot of the system by administrators. In this example, we're going to telling the Apache server to be starting Apache manually and then telling the system to launch Apache 2 on boot. Enter the use of systemctl. This command allows us to interact with the system process daemon. Continuing on with our example, systemctl is an easy to use command to take this following syntax: systemctl option and servers. I guess it says all you need to know about this command. So what command would be used to start the sim on the boot up of the device? It would be systemctl enable. I guess it's enable. I hope so. Yep. There we have it, and now we know if you use this, this service will start on boot up. This can be handy on some cases. What command would we use to bring a previously backgrounded process back to the foreground? Okay, this is something important. Let's say you're running an algorithm that is supposed to create a word list with, let's say, 6 digits length. This will take some time, even on really great CPUs. So if we want to do something while this happens, we can use Control and Y, I guess it's on English keyboards, or Z on German keyboards. Jesus Christ. And if we want to do this, then we are backgrounding a process, which means it works in the background, and once it's finished, but you can always bring it back to the foreground via FG. So, like you can see here, CTRL plus Z or the AND operator to bring it background and FG to bring it foreground. I can't really show this to you because I don't really have a process to do this. So, all right, maintaining your system. Now we're coming to cron jobs or cron tabs, something that you will really need when you do CTF, because sometimes people want specific things to happen in your Linux system at specific times or dates, and if that happens, you want to use cron tabs. Let's say cron tab minus E. Now we have our cron tab here and can see what happens. Here we have a cron tab called add reboot, and we need to start var op processes.sh. Okay. So ensure you're connected to the boot instance and look at the running cron tabs. Yep. What will the cron tab on the deployed instance run? Add reboot. Yep, that's all for this task. Here you can even see what are the specific requirements of a special job to start or end. It's quite interesting. And you will see that a lot on CTFs. So maintaining. This is the sources list. I will give it another video because it's more or less a list where your Linux uses to access the packets or dependencies to download in case you want to update your Linux, to make it really, really short. You will find it under, can I do it even here? So let's say you want to use it, etc, etc, at sources list, and then you have it here. I'm not root yet, so I can't edit it, but yeah, you can totally add some packages there if you want. So our last challenge for today is maintaining your system logs. For this challenge, we need to be in our attack box again. Every Linux system has logs in every kind. So let's access these logs, var log, and look, and let's take a look at this. So those are some of our logs. For this quest, we need to use the Apache 2 logs. We have the access log and the error log. I guess you can already see where this is get going. The access log is more or less who accessed something on your web server and what. And the error log is, like it says, error messages. So look at the Apache 2 logs on the deployed machine. We did it. What is the IP of the address user who visited the site? So like I said, accesses, who visited it, what visited, and how. Let's open it. Accesslog.1. So we have somebody here from this IP, which is the answer to this. And which file did they access? They accessed the catsanddogs.jpg. And with this and this, we are finished. We just did this room and we got a badge. I'm really happy because this room is an easy and fun room to start your experience with Linux. And I will continue doing the complete beginner path for the first. And I hope you learned something. I am not English native speaking, so I'm really sorry if I was a bit not understandable. So we are going to see us in the next video. See you soon. Bye.